Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen wa salatu wa salamu ala nabi al-kareem wa ala alihi wa ashabi ajma'een. We begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and asking Allah to send His peace and blessings upon the final prophet Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and all those who follow his way with righteousness until the end of times. Welcome to another virtual khutbah, where today, inshallah, we will be discussing the topic of shukr or gratitude during times of difficulty. So this may seem like a strange topic to some people. Why talk about gratitude during difficult times? I mean, we're going through a really hard time right now, as an ummah, as a whole, as a world as a whole. And, you know, generally during times like this, our lectures focus on sabr, on patience. And I have discussed that many times over the past few months. So I wanted to give us a different perspective this week instead. Something a bit more optimistic, but more hopeful to help us through this difficult time. It is a difficult time, definitely. And I mean, this past week alone, we've lost a lot of people we know in our community. Very influential members of this community have passed away, including some of my own teachers and other people that I knew. And we ask Allah to accept their deaths as martyrdom and to grant them Jannah and to forgive them for their sins. We ask Allah to protect us from this pandemic and to lift it soon and to return the world to normal as soon. And we'll continue to make this dua and to remain optimistic until the very end. So, optimism or having good thoughts about Allah is a very important part of our religion. And one of the ways to achieve this is through gratitude, to be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That the more we have in our lives to be grateful for, or the more that we recognize in our lives to be grateful for, the more optimistic and hopeful and happy and excited we are with our lives. And so it's important that no matter what situation we are in, we look for things to thank Allah for and to be grateful to Allah for. Now, many of us have this idea that the way that the test of the world is that when we are going through good times, our test is to have shukr, to have gratitude. And when we are going through difficult times, then our test is sabr, to be patient with those calamities. But there's actually a higher level of iman. The higher level of iman is to express our sabr and shukr in both situations. That during good times, we are grateful, but we also have sabr. And during bad times, we are patient, but we also have shukr. Now, this may be a bit difficult to understand if you haven't heard of this concept before. So, I'm going to break it down with some examples. Let's start off with the good times, right? So, just say that someone becomes a millionaire, and they experiencing for the first time in their life great wealth and financial freedom. And now they are going through a good time in their life. So generally, we would assume that in that situation, the test of life is shukr, right? To be grateful to Allah for that wealth, to use it in a way that is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to express one's gratitude to Allah through dhikr, to saying alhamdulillah, to salah, to charity, to all of these different things. So we assume this is now a time only for shukr. But it's actually a time for sabr as well. Because, again, many of us are unaware of the fact that the word sabr has a variety of meanings, a variety of layers. That sabr does not refer to patience with calamities only. That's one type of sabr. There are other dimensions to sabr as well. Because from the meanings of the word sabr is self-control. From the meanings of the word sabr is perseverance. And so, these elements of sabr come into play when one is going through good times. So, for example, if one becomes a millionaire, it's now easy to commit zina. It's now easy to gamble without worrying about losing all of one's money. It's now easy to gain access to expensive drugs and alcohol. And it's easy to get away with these sins without getting in trouble. So the door to sin becomes easier. And the nafs may crave these sins. So sabr at a time of wealth and affluence is to stay away from these things even though your nafs really wants them. The sabr here is self-control. Likewise, when one suddenly becomes wealthy and you're going through a good time in life, then at such a time, it becomes easy to get lazy about one's ibadat. Start to salat al-fajr, a person stops praying fajr on time. And then they stop praying the salah altogether. And so they stop persevering in the good deeds. And so the other type of sabr that is needed at times of ease is to persevere in one's good deeds, to remain persistent on fajr, even though you have got an extra comfy bed and you've got everything you want in this dunya, and your nafs and shaitan are whispering to you and telling you that you don't need salah and all of these things are there. To remain committed to your ibadat is now a type of sabr. So that means at good times, we need both sabr and shukr. We have to thank Allah for the goodness in our lives. وَلَا إِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ Allah promises us that if you are grateful, Allah will give you even more. But at the same time, we have to be persistent on our good deeds, and we have to be in self-control away from sins. And this can be very, very difficult at the time of ease. And this is why some of the scholars in the field of purification of the soul, they actually say that the sabr at the time of ease is harder than the sabr at the time of difficulty. Why? Because at the time of difficulty, you really have no choice except to have sabr. Everybody has sabr at times of difficulty, or almost everybody. I mean, even the atheist has sabr at a time of difficulty, because there is no other way to get through it, right? Except through patience. So that's actually the easier type of patience. But to remain committed to one's ibadat during times of ease, to stay away from sins during times of ease, this is a lot more difficult, and it's only really the pious who are able to do this. And so this is the greater type of sabr, and this is something that helps us to attain a higher stage of piety during times of ease. But you may be saying, but we're not going through times of ease. We're going through a pandemic, we're going through a time of difficulty. So what's this got to do with our situation? And what this has to do with our situation is the opposite, right? I spoke about sabr during times of ease. What about the opposite? What about shukr during times of difficulty? Then you may think, why shukr? I mean, we're going through a really tough time right now. People are losing their jobs. People are sick. People are dying every day. There are dozens of janazas. It's crazy. What's there to have shukr for? And I say there's always something to have shukr for. There's always something to express gratitude for. There's always something to thank Allah for. And this is the higher level of iman. This is the piety that we should aim for. To be able to see the good in every situation. Now, again, I remind you that our religion is a religion of optimism. It's a religion of always trying to see the good in everything and every situation. It's a religion where no matter how bad things get, there's always something good, either happening right now or on the horizon. And that our focus is on that. And so if you look at the surahs, the early surahs revealed during a time of difficulty, for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Surah Ad-Duha and Surah Al-Inshirah. Actually, these two surahs, they come one after the other in the Quran, and they flow together almost like one surah with a common theme and a common rhythm style, to such an extent that some early Muslims actually consider them to be a single surah, and they were revealed together as well. Now, when you look at these two surahs, the common theme in both of these surahs, despite being revealed at a time of difficulty, the common theme is not sabr, but it's optimism. It's to look at the good, either right now or on the horizon. So Surah Ad-Duha is about optimism about the future, right? That soon Allah will give you that which is better for you, right? وَلَلْآخِرُ خَيْرُ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى That what is to come is better than what has passed. That it's all about the future. It's all about good things are going to happen. And then at the end of the surah, it's about gratitude for what you already have. The surah is revealed while the Prophet ﷺ is going through a difficult time. Allah calls him to make shukr. Allah tells him, remember that you were poor and we gave you wealth. Remember that you were an orphan and we gave your family. Remember that you were searching and we guided you to prophethood. It's all a reminder of Allah's favors, a reminder to be grateful during difficult times. Shukr during difficult times. That's what Allah called the Prophet ﷺ towards. And then in Surah Al-Inshirah, Allah tells us, Inna ma'al usri yusra. And this is a slogan of ours, but we often translate it as after difficulty there is ease. The actual wording is with difficulty there is ease. Meaning, whatever test Allah sends us, there's something else in our life that's an ease at the same time. So for example, someone may lose their job, but at the same time, they may form closer bonds with their family members, right? Or somebody may be experiencing the death of a loved one, but at the same time, they may be gaining a large inheritance. Or so whatever it is, you're going through hardship that you have to have sabr with. But at the same time, there's something you're not looking at that you need to be grateful for as well. And we see this in the attitude of the righteous throughout history, that no matter how bad things got, they always focus on the good, and they always look for something to be grateful for. And we see this in the life of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, that there is a narration attributed to him that whenever something bad used to happen, something that we would assume that we have to have sabr with, he would look for a reason to thank Allah, to be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he would look at things like, alhamdulillah, this hasn't affected my iman. Alhamdulillah, all I lost was dunya. I didn't lose anything to do with my deen. No, he would look for the good. He would be highly optimistic, and he would fill himself with gratitude towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even during difficult times. The Sahaba, they had such an attitude of gratitude that they would even be grateful to Allah for death itself. Even for death itself. That for many of us, this death, it's a scary thing. It's something we're terrified of. It's something that we can't see any good in it. Yet when you look at the early Muslims, you know, they also had these human fears, but they counted it with their belief that there is good waiting for us on the other side. And so the Prophet ﷺ, he taught us this. He said that whoever wishes to meet Allah, Allah wishes to meet them. Meaning at the time of death, we should be excited to meet Allah. We should be wanting to meet Allah. We should be have this positive attitude that I'm going to meet Allah. This is a good thing. Inshallah, it's going to be a good thing. And we see this, for example, when the great Sahabi, the mother of the believers, the beloved wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the great scholar of Islam, Aisha bint Abi Bakr radiallahu anha, when she was passing away, is an absolutely beautiful story narrated in almost all of the books of hadith narrators. It's in Bidayah wa Nihaya, it's in Al-Dhahabi's Sir An-Nubala, it's in all of these great books. It's a beautiful story that when Aisha is passing away, Abdullah ibn Abbas seeks permission to visit her. And immediately we learn the lesson that when someone is passing away, we should visit them. Now, obviously, in a pandemic, we can't do that, but we should maybe give them a call or call their family, whatever is within our abilities, we do. So Abdullah ibn Abbas, he visits her, and what does he tell her? This is the point that's related. I mean, there's many beautiful things he tells her, and I mentioned this in a previous khutbah about dealing with death, but there's one point related to this specific topic. What does he tell her? He tells her good news. Soon you will be with the Prophet ﷺ and those whom you love. Again, looking for the good in every situation. Someone is dying and Abdullah ibn Abbas is looking for the good in the situation. That yes, you're leaving this body. The good news is that soon you will be with those whom you love, including the Prophet ﷺ. That once your soul leaves this body, it's no longer constrained by the three dimensions of this world. It is now in Alamul Barzakh, where you can meet the other souls of the righteous and be with the other souls of the righteous and be with the souls of your loved ones. This is a good thing. And so we look for the good in every situation. And we see this in the hadith about plagues itself, that the Prophet ﷺ said that plagues and pandemics are Allah's punishment to this world, but they are a mercy to the believer. Again, look at the way he phrased it, that yes, these are punishments. Yes, this is something to make us reflect, something to make us make tawbah, something to make us turn our lives around, something that's going to take the people who lived evil lives towards Jahannam. But there's also good in it. It's also a mercy to the believers. How is it a mercy to the believers? It's going to take people to Jannah as well. Someone could have spent their entire lives committing major sins, and then they die in a pandemic, and they die a death of a martyr, and Allah forgives all of their sins, and they go to Jannah. That is the best thing that could have ever happened to that individual. To see the good in times like this, this is something that's really, that's unique to our religion. That we have this optimistic view of everything. I mean, even the end times, we have an optimistic view of the end times. That the Prophet ﷺ said that if you have a seed in your hands and you're going to plant it and the world is ending, just go ahead and plant it. Just be optimistic in every situation. And so we see this throughout history, that the Muslims looked for the good in everything. And we have this famous statement from Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah that's become like a proverb that people quote in whenever they face difficulties. Again, when you look at the statement of Ibn Taymiyyah, he's going through difficulty and he's not looking at it from a sabr perspective, he's looking at it from a shukr perspective. He's looking at the things to be grateful to Allah for in the times of difficulty. What's a famous statement of his? Well, he says, my Jannah is in my heart, what can they do with me? If they imprison me, that's alone time with Allah. It's a time for meditation, it's a time for zikr, it's a time for ibadat. Right? If they kill me, it's martyrdom. Right? Whatever they do, it is something that's going to benefit me. There's something to be grateful to Allah for in whatever happens to me. And so we see in this attitude of gratitude in every situation. And it's not only Ibn Taymiyyah who had this, it's all of the righteous throughout our history, that they look for the good in whatever happened to them. That they would see it as a blessing from Allah. Things that we see as calamities, things that we see as trials, things that we see as punishments, they look for a way to see it as a blessing, as a way to thank, to find something to thank Allah for. Now, what happens when we do this? What happens when we live a life of gratitude, even during difficult times? There are three benefits that we immediately get out of being grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during difficult times. Number one is an increase in our iman itself, right? That if you are able to find things to be grateful for during difficult times, automatically that is an iman boost. Automatically that brings you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Automatically that increases your taqwa. So this is a major plus that, you know, for many people, difficult situations like what we're going through right now, it rocks their iman, it shakes their iman. And so when you find things to thank Allah for, alhamdulillah, I'm still alive. Alhamdulillah, I'm still a Muslim. Alhamdulillah, so-and-so passed away upon iman. Inshallah, they have the death of a martyr. You're looking at the good in every difficulty. It strengthens your iman. It strengthens your conviction in this religion. It firms your heart. And this is itself a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second benefit we get from shukr at times of difficulty is an increase in the good things in our lives. Again, going back to the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised us, وَلَا إِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ, that if you are grateful, I will give you more. So imagine you're going through all of this hardship and then you thank Allah for your good health. Allah will give you more good health. You're going through all of this hardship and you thank Allah for your iman. Allah will give you more iman. You thank Allah for your home. Allah will bless your home. You thank Allah for your family. Allah will bless your family. Remember, more doesn't necessarily mean more in numbers. It means sometimes increase in barakah, increase in effect, increase in the goodness, right? There's different ways in which this increase comes about. So, doesn't mean that if you thank Allah for your house, Allah is going to give you a second house. But it could mean that Allah will put barakah in that home and make it a source of sakina and happiness and contentment for you and your family, right? So the second benefit that we get out of gratitude is an increase in the good things. And at times of difficulty, we want an increase in good things. We want as much increase in good things as possible. So while the whole world is crashing down around us, that we are sitting and saying, alhamdulillah for my iman, alhamdulillah for my health, alhamdulillah for my job, alhamdulillah for my home, alhamdulillah for my family, whatever it is, alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah, you are causing an increase in all of these good things. And so over time, even though the rest of the world may be going through calamity, you may be experiencing an increase in good things in your life because you are maintaining an attitude of shukr even in the most difficult of times. And then we have the third benefit. What is the third benefit of shukr during times of difficulty? It is a psychological benefit. The psychological benefit of having an attitude of gratitude during difficult times is that it prevents depression. And we know one of the biggest problems that come out of this kind of situations where we're going through pandemic and mass debt, and we're dealing with the loss of loved ones, and we're dealing with lockdowns and being cut off from our societies, one of the biggest mental health problems that come about from this is depression. That people get depressed. There is just so much negativity in the world that people fall into depression. Now, if you are taking time every day to thank Allah for the good things in your life, you are maintaining a positive mindset. This positive mindset will, inshallah, help to prevent depression. It's not the only thing, Of course, some people have, they are more disposed towards depression than others, and they may need more assistance, they may need counseling, they may need other things. But, you know, it does play a role in being a preventative measure. That when you are focused on the good in your life, it prevents those negative thoughts from overwhelming you. And we see throughout our history that whenever things like this took place, one of the main problems that societies faced was a depression that just like overtook everybody. You know, when you read the Book of Plagues by Ibn Hajar Asqalani, he describes that, you know, when the plagues got really bad, people just gave up on life. Like, they just gave up. They stopped working, they stopped doing good deeds, they just gave up. And it didn't happen to everybody. It happened to those who did not maintain their relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, who became overwhelmed with the problems of this world. They were the ones who just gave up. Ibn Hajar himself lived through a plague. That's why he wrote that book on plagues. And he lost four of his daughters to the plague. May Allah protect us from something like that ever happening. Can you imagine losing four daughters in one plague? Yet despite that, he never gave up. He never, you know, became unproductive. Rather, he wrote the largest Islamic book on plagues. And he went on to write Fathul Bari and many other amazing books about our religion and became one of the greatest scholars of all time. And so he was able to maintain that. Why? What was the difference between someone like him who lived through a plague and accomplished so much, and others who just, as he said in his lifetime, he saw people just giving up on life? What was the difference? The difference is a mindset. And one of the ways to maintain that positive mindset is every day, no matter how difficult things get, no matter how bad the situation is, no matter who passes away or who loses what, to try and find something to thank Allah for. Even if it's just thanking Allah that you are still a Muslim. Even if it's just thanking Allah that you lost dunya and not deen. Even if it's thanking Allah for taking your life in a way that would inshallah be accepted as martyrdom. But finding something to thank Allah for, this is the mindset of a believer. We said the minimum level, what's required of us in difficulties, is sabr. Allah has given good news to those who have sabr. وَبَشْرِ صَابِرِينَ, give good news to those who have sabr. And he has told us to seek his assistance through sabr. And the Prophet has said that sabr must be there at the moment that the calamity begins. But how do you elevate that? How do you reach the next level? Remember, we are not concerned with minimum. We are concerned with ihsan, with becoming the absolute best we can be, so we can attain the highest possible level of paradise and have the best akhirah possible. We want to be from those who Allah describes as the muqarrabun, those who are close to him, right? How do we get there? We get there by not just having sabr, but having shukr as well. Whether it's a good time or a bad time, we maintain both states in our heart. That we are always in a state of sabr and shukr simultaneously. So while we are having sabr with all of the calamities in our lives, we are looking for good things to have shukr with as well. We are looking for things to thank Allah for as well. And this helps us to maintain a positive mindset. It helps us to be optimistic. It helps us to hold back depression. It helps us to have things to look forward to live for. And it helps us, inshallah, to get to Jannah as well. And so this is the mindset that I want us to move forward with. That yes, we are going through a very difficult time. Every day we are receiving dozens of janazah notifications. People we know have passed away. People we know are in hospital. Many of us who are watching this have been through the virus and recovered from it. And many of us watching this have lost loved ones. People have lost their jobs. People have lost their businesses. People are in the intensive care unit. There is so much going on in the world right now that makes life very difficult. Life is a test. And one of the ways to truly excel at that test and to get an A in that exam and to attain a close rank with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to maintain a positive mindset and to maintain shukr no matter what is going on in our lives. And so we ask Allah to grant us hearts that are full of sabr, hearts that are full of shukr, hearts that are full of love, hearts that are full of hope, hearts that are full of fear, hearts that are full of Allah and Iman, and hearts that are attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to protect us from ever being tested in our Iman. That we are tested with dunya, that is something that is going to disappear anyway. Our wealth is temporary, our health is temporary, our lives are temporary. What matters most is our iman. And we ask Allah that whether He grants us a long life or a short life, that He grants us death upon iman in a way that is pleasing to Him, and that He grants us the eternity of Jannat al-Firdaus. Subhana rabbil izzati amma yasifun, wa salamu ala mursaleen, walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.